Well, welcome to our last session today. It's been a long day, hasn't it? Yes. I mean, maybe five presentations in one day is a bit much, especially for you. You have to sit there. There's no risk of me going to sleep. I'd be in trouble if I did. In our last session, we're going to study lesson number 47, and the title of the lesson is Seeking Places of Honor. And we'll have a word of prayer, and then I will read the parable. It's a medium-sized parable, and then we'll get right into our study. Let's bow our heads. Father in heaven, it's been a very productive day. We thank you now that we're able to meet here as we begin your holy Sabbath, to open your holy book, and we ask that your Holy Spirit will be present with us. We want to know what your will is. We want to be willing servants. So we ask that you will teach us what we need to learn from this very important lesson, Seeking Places of Honor. And we thank you for hearing our prayer, for answering our prayer. We claim the promise of your answer in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right, the parable that we're going to look at is Luke 14. Verses 7 through 11. And I'm going to read the parable, and then of course we are going to study it. The parable reads in the following way. So he told a parable to those who were invited, when he noted how they chose the best places, saying to them, "When you are invited by anyone to a wedding feast, do not sit down in the best place, lest one more honorable than you be invited by him, and he who invited you and him come and say to you, 'Give place to this man,' and then you begin with shame to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit down in the lowest place, so that when he who invited you comes, he may say to you, 'Friend, go up higher.' Then you will have glory in the presence of those who sit at the table with you. For whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted." Very simple parable. Not complicated to understand. Basically, to synthesize, it's saying that if you're invited to a wedding feast, don't take the places up front. Take an inconspicuous place. And then, you know, the individual who invited you, he'll come back, he says, "Oh no, not back there, sit up here." But if you sit way up there and somebody more important than you comes, you'll suffer the embarrassment of having the person who invited you say, "Would you please go to the back of the room?" So, you know, it's a very simple parable, but very, very powerful. And we're going to see that this theme appears in many other teachings of Jesus. So let's go to the first section. I'll bet you can't guess to whom especially this parable is directed at. Anybody want to guess? How did you know that? The Pharisees. Let's go to number one. To whom and in what context did Jesus tell this parable? Well, it says in Luke chapter 14 and verse 1, "Now it happened as he went into the house of one of the rulers of the Pharisees to eat bread on the Sabbath that they watched him closely." So this parable was spoken to the guests that were invited to partake of a meal in the house of a Pharisee. So it's a real life situation, but it's also a parable where Jesus is clearly saying, you know, you need to be careful where you sit when you come to the banquet. Number two, what further evidence do we have that this parable was directed at the Pharisees? Well, let's notice what we find here in Matthew 23, verses 2 and verses 5 through 7. Then Jesus spoke to the multitudes and to his disciples, saying, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat." Now let me just stop there for a moment. Moses' seat was not an actual seat. This is a figurative expression that basically means that the Pharisees and the scribes had the authority to teach. It's kind of like speaking of the papal throne. You know, when the Pope speaks, they say he speaks ex cathedra. That means from the throne. And if you go to St. Peter's in the Vatican, you'll find way at the, you know, you go through the front door and way on, towards the back of the building, you have this huge throne that is elevated way above. The Pope doesn't sit on it. It's just kind of like a ceremonial thing that has the intention of saying that the Pope has the authority to speak in the name of Peter and all of his successors. So this is not a literal throne. This is simply a symbolic throne that the Pharisees and the scribes conceived that gave them authority to teach infallibly. So coming back here, then Jesus spoke to the multitudes and to his disciples, saying, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat, but all their works they do to what? To be seen by men. They make the phylacteries broad." Phylacteries were little boxes where they would put little pieces of parchment with verses from the writings of Moses. And they were very conspicuous because they would take these and they would put them here on their forehead, which means, you know, that they had those scriptures in their forehead. Well, it was in a little box stuck to their forehead. It wasn't inside. But it gave an air of very much piety. The name of those, by the way, is Tefillim. So, but all their works they do to be seen by men. They make their phylacteries broad and enlarge the borders of their garments. These are parchments with scriptures tied on the forehead, and of course the borders of their garments. They adorned the borders of their garments to be seen. They love, now here comes the key portion, they love the what? The best places at feasts. Does that square with the parable that we're studying? Absolutely. The best seats in the synagogues, greetings in the marketplaces, and to be called by men, Rabbi, Rabbi. So you can kind of catch the nuance of why Jesus told this parable. Because the scribes and the Pharisees, you know, they like the best places at the feasts, the best seats in the synagogues. They love for people to greet them and to say Rabbi, Rabbi, which means teacher, teacher. Now let's read the note. The expression Moses' seat refers not to a little literal chair, but rather to an elevated position of power that supposedly authorized the scribes and Pharisees to teach. And incidentally, just as a sidelight, the view of tradition that was held by the Jewish leaders in Christ's day was virtually identical to the view of tradition that the Roman Catholic Church has. You know, there's three elements. There's a deposit of the faith, where you have the written scriptures and you have the oral traditions that supposedly were handed down from Moses from generation to generation. So you have the deposit of the faith. And then you have a transmitting agent, which is the idea that it was transmitted to the elders, and they transmit it to others, and they transmit it to others. And then you have the magisterium, which is the body that exists at any given moment that has the authority to authoritatively interpret which traditions are trustworthy and which traditions are not. And the view of tradition of the Roman Catholic Church is virtually identical to the view that was held by the religious leaders in Christ's day. If you are interested in more on this, I did a series called The Bible or Tradition, where the first several presentations I go through the Jewish view of tradition, and I read from Jewish sources, and then I show the Roman Catholic view of tradition, and it's virtually identical. And Ellen White has a statement where she says that their view of tradition ultimately led to the rejection of Christ. And of course the Roman Catholic view of tradition also, they introduce all kinds of teachings that are not found in the Bible, and they say, well, that's in the deposit of tradition that was passed on from generation to generation orally. So, you know, and that's of authority because the magisterium, you know, is composed of scholars that know what they're talking about. So those oral traditions are just as trustworthy as written scripture. That's just a sidelight. And I hope that at some point you watch this series. It's all over the place on YouTube. And so just type in my last name and put the name the Bible or tradition, they'll come up. You'll be able to see them. Okay, what counsel did Jesus give to these arrogant spiritual leaders? Here's the counsel of Jesus in this same chapter. And do not be called teachers, for one is your teacher, the Christ. Now this doesn't mean that we can't call our school teachers teachers. This is speaking of the spiritual realm. But he who is greatest among you shall be your servant. Does that sound familiar? Does that sound kind of like the parable? You know, the first will be last and the last first. Different words are used, but it means the same. Among you shall be your servant, and whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. By the way, did you notice something interesting here? It says whoever exalts himself, that's the person that's doing it. And then it says will be humbled. Somebody else is doing the humbling. Are you following me or not? And he who humbles himself, in other words, if you choose to humble yourself, somebody else is going to exalt you, because it's in the passive voice. So the humbling and the exalting is something that people do themselves. And then depending on whether they humble or exalt themselves, God will humble or exalt. It is important to note the attitude of the Pharisees. While the Pharisees exalted themselves, that's an active voice, someone else would humble them, passive voice. Likewise, those who humble themselves, active voice, would be exalted by another, passive voice. Number four, with what kind of attitude did the Pharisees do charitable deeds and pray? Take heed that you do not do your charitable deeds before men to be seen by them. Otherwise you have no reward from your Father in heaven. And when you pray, you shall not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen by men. So in other words, the religion in the days of Christ was a big show that attracted attention to whom? To the religious leaders. It wasn't about God at all. It was about them. They prayed to be seen. They wanted to be called rabbi, to be seen. They wanted the first positions in the synagogue, the first positions in the feasts. You know, it was all a religion that was centered in the religious leaders and not in glorifying the Lord. Number five, what kind of attitude did the publican manifest in contrast to the Pharisee? You remember the story of the Pharisee and the publican? It's one of the lessons. We haven't studied it. We're not going to study it because we don't have enough time to go through all of the lessons. But you know, the Pharisee, he goes to the temple to pray, and so does the publican. And the Pharisee, the Bible says he prays to himself. That's interesting. He prays to himself and he says, thank you that I'm not like other men. I fast twice a week. And he probably would have said, I keep the Sabbath and I tithe of everything that comes into me. He says, and especially Lord, I'm thankful that I'm not like this miserable publican, a big sinner. So what is the attitude of the Pharisee? I mentioned this, two characteristics. Number one, they exalt themselves, they feel like they can earn salvation by their works. And secondly, they disdain those who don't reach their level of piety in their estimation. And in the story of the publican and the Pharisee, this comes through in living color. But then the publican comes, and it says that he doesn't even dare come near to the Lord. In fact, it says that he doesn't even look up, he looks down, and he beats his breast. Notice that he's really sorry for being a sinner, and he says, "Be merciful to me, O Lord, a sinner." Do you see the difference in the piety of one and the other? One was a facade, a sham, hypocrisy, whereas the other was sincere in realizing he was a sinner and confessing his sin. And by the way, Jesus said that the publican went home justified. That is the only time in the Gospels where Jesus used the word justified. You know, that's a common word in the writings of the Apostle Paul, justification. And the spirit of prophecy emphasizes that the word justification is the same as forgiveness. Justification is forgiveness. So in other words, the publican went home justified, whereas the Pharisee went home self-justified. And to be self-justified is to be lost. Now let's notice here then how Jesus ends this parable of the Pharisee and the publican. What kind of attitude did the publican manifest in contrast to the Pharisee? And the tax collector, standing afar off, would not so much as raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." And then Jesus gives his interpretation. "I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other." And here comes the formula. This formula appears time and again in the teachings of Jesus. What does it say? "For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted." Have we seen that before in the parable? Absolutely. And we noticed also that it's similar when you say that he is who is the greatest should make himself what? The most humble. And he is the most humble in the estimation of God is the greatest. It's basically the same thing, but with different terminology. Now let's notice the strife that existed among the disciples on a certain occasion. Number one, page 354, at the bottom of the page. What were the disciples arguing about on the last journey to Jerusalem? Well, you can read the passages that are in parentheses there, Mark 9:33-35, Luke 9:46, and chapter 10:29-31. We need to compare all Gospels when they deal with common matters. It says, "Then he came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them." Now he's going to ask the disciples something. They've traveled and they've arrived in this place. And Jesus asked the question, "What was it you disputed among yourselves on the road?" In other words, what were you guys fighting about as we were traveling here? "But they kept silent, for on the road they had disputed among themselves who would be the greatest." Was the spirit of the Pharisees contagious?
Yes.
Oh, very much contagious. They were fighting over who would occupy the first places in the kingdom. Number two, what surprising counsel did Jesus give to his disciples when they disputed among who among them would be the greatest? Once again, we're going to meet the same formula all over again. He sat down, called the 12 and said to them, "If anyone desires to be first, he shall be last of all and servant of all." And now he's going to give an object lesson. He says, if you want to be the greatest in the kingdom, the first, then you have to be willing to be the last. Take the last place. In other words, take the last seat and then you'll be put in front. But if you go to the front to exalt yourself, you're going to be put in the back, and it's going to be awful embarrassing. So now notice what Jesus does. Then he took a little child and set him in the midst of them. And when he had taken him in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever receives one of these little children in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives not me, but him who sent me." So he's saying we need to have the simplicity of a child. You know, a child is not fighting to sit on the throne. A child is out playing in the yard. Now notice the explanation we have here in the note. The disciples did their best to keep the children away from Jesus because they considered that they were not worthy of notice. In their mind they were young, inexperienced, a nuisance. After all, what could a simple child teach them? Yet Jesus taught that they needed to have the humility of a child. Now here comes another episode. Interesting. A mother, of course she loves her sons, she comes to Jesus and she says, "Oh, I have these two precious boys." And you know, these two precious boys, they're so smart and they're so good. I'd love to have them sit one at your right and the other on your left when you enter your kingdom. Now let's read about it. What request did the mother of James and John present to Jesus? Then the mother of Zebedee's sons came to him with her sons, kneeling down and asking something from him. And he said to her, "What do you wish?" In other words, what do you want? What's your request? She said to him, "Grant that these two sons of mine may sit one on your right hand and the other on the left in your kingdom." Give them the two highest positions in the kingdom, is what she's saying. Now, you know, you have to understand the heart of a mother. You know, she thinks her kids are the best, and she wants them to occupy these positions. Now, when the other disciples saw that this request had been made by the mother, they get angry with the disciples, with James and John. Notice number four. How did the other disciples feel about the mother's request? And when the 10 heard it, they were greatly displeased with the two brothers. Not with the mother, because evidently the brothers had put their mother up to it. They'd said, "Hey mom, tell Jesus that in the kingdom we want to be one on one side and one on the other." They wouldn't dare do it themselves to the rabbi. But mommy, yeah, she might be able to be successful in getting that. And then I want you to notice what counsel Jesus gave. See, immediately after all these episodes where you have someone who is exalting himself, somebody who wants the first place, somebody who wants the position of power, immediately afterwards Jesus now gives a teaching about it. Number five, what counsel did Jesus give to the disgusted disciples? But Jesus called them to himself and said, "You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who are great exercise authority over them. Those who are great exercise authority over them. Yet it shall not be so among you, but whoever desires to become great among you, let him be your servant." Same teaching, yes or no? Same teaching. "And whoever desires to be first among you, let him be your slave, just as the Son." Now he's going to say why. He said, "You're going to follow my example." He says, "Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many." So Jesus had the first position. And he came down and he made himself a servant. So Jesus says, "I came to give my life. You don't be like the Pharisees, be like me." Now let's take a closer look at this issue of the first and the last. This formula appears quite a few times, doesn't it? Now let's notice the rich young ruler. After Jesus encountered the rich young ruler, what did he promise his disciples if they gave up all for him? Because after Jesus told the rich young ruler, go sell all that you have and give to the poor, the rich young man left and he was sad because he had many possessions. And so now Peter says, if a rich man can't be saved, who's going to be saved? Well, notice what Jesus had to say. And everyone who has left houses, or brothers, or sisters, or father, or mother, or wife, or children, or lands, for my name's sake, shall receive a hundredfold and inherit eternal life. And now comes the formula again. But many who are first will be last, and the last first. Was this a central teaching of Jesus? In all of these episodes, you find this idea that the greatest is the one who places himself last. Now let's notice where this whole idea of exalting and humbling comes from. The Bible's two mysteries. These days the world is full of people who have a thirst for power, riches, recognition. Theirs is a serious case of an insatiable desire for upward mobility at the expense of service to others. The question is, where did this spirit of wanting the first places and the most prominent places originate? And where does it ultimately lead? In order to answer this question, we must pay a visit to life in heaven before the creation of the world. What was the ruling principle in heaven before the inception of sin? This is a beautiful description that Ellen White provides in Great Controversy 493. Before the entrance of evil, there was peace and joy throughout the universe. All was in perfect harmony with the Creator's will. Love for God was supreme, love for one another impartial. So you'll notice that there was no rivalry, no competition in heaven. Everybody was happy with the position that they had. They loved one another. But now we have what is known as the mystery of iniquity. Notice 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 verses 3 and 4. We're going to find exemplified this teaching of Jesus: whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted. Here the Apostle Paul wrote, let no one deceive you by any means. For that day, that is the day of Christ's coming, will not come unless the falling away comes first. The expression falling away is the Greek word apostasia. So Jesus is not going to come until first there is the apostasy. And the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, and now notice this, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. What characterizes the mystery of iniquity? The mystery of iniquity is when a mere man exalts himself above everyone else, and he shows himself that he is God. In other words, he's down here and he attempts to occupy the position of God up there. Those who abide by the principles of the mystery of iniquity are unable to comprehend how anyone would want to be second fiddle. The mindset of the world is to ascend, to get rich, to accumulate power, to flaunt academic degrees. Ellen White explained it this way: the religion of the Bible is simply the mystery of godliness. No human mind can fully understand it, and it is utterly incomprehensible to the unregenerate heart. In other words, the unregenerate heart says, it's ridiculous that you want to serve people, and that you want to use your riches to help other people, and that you don't want the highest position of power. You know, to the unregenerate heart, that's ridiculous. Now let's notice where this spirit of the papacy came from, because 2 Thessalonians 2 is speaking about the apostasy of the papacy. It's speaking about the Pope wanting to exalt himself, a mere man wanting to exalt himself to occupy the position of God. This comes from the very beginning of human history. What type of a mobility did Lucifer come to exhibit in heaven? Well, you know this passage from the book of Isaiah, chapter 14, verses 12 through 14. For you have said in your heart, I will what? Ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation on the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. What kind of mobility did Lucifer portray? Upward mobility. But this comes from him. He is exalting himself, right? Is that the same thing that the man of sin does that we just read in 2 Thessalonians 2? He exalts himself, he wants to take the position of God. The system does the same as its leader. That's why Ellen White calls the papacy the vice regent of Satan, because it manifests the same spirit. Number two, according to the prophet Isaiah, what type of mobility will Satan suffer because of his desire to ascend? So he who exalts himself, what is going to happen? He will be humbled by someone else. So let's notice what Isaiah 14, 12 through 15 has to say. What will be the fruit of Lucifer's desire to ascend and exalt himself to a higher position than God gave him? According to the prophet Isaiah, this is what's going to happen to Lucifer. Actually, part of it already happened. How you are what? What kind of mobility is that? Down. How you are fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning. How you are cut down to the ground, you who weakened the nations. You. And then it continues saying, yet you shall be brought down to Sheol, that's the grave, to the lowest depths of the pit. Is he doing this, or is somebody else doing it to him? Did you notice the passive verbs here? He who exalts himself will be humbled. Lucifer exalted himself. He said, I will be like the Most High. God says, oh no, 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 no. You're fallen. You're going to be cut down. You're going to go so far down to the lowest parts of the pit. He who exalts himself will be humbled. Now, according to Ezekiel, what spirit did Lucifer exhibit in heaven? We're question number three. Ezekiel is in harmony with what Isaiah said. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. You corrupted your wisdom for the sake of your splendor. So notice what kind of mobility do we have here? His heart is what? Lifted up. Is he exalting himself? Yes. Ellen White vividly wrote about Lucifer's desire for upward mobility. Let's notice what Ellen White had to say. Little by little, Lucifer came to indulge in the desire for self-exaltation. What does exaltation mean? The desire to ascend, right? The scripture says, thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. Thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness. Thou hast said in thy heart, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will be like the Most High. Though all his glory was from God, this mighty angel came to regard it as pertaining to himself. Not content with his position, though honored above the heavenly host, he ventured to covet homage due only to the Creator, instead of seeking to make God supreme in the affections and allegiance of all created beings. It was his endeavor to secure their service and loyalty to himself. So in other words, instead of serving, he wants to be served. And coveting the glory with which the infinite Father had invested his Son, this prince of angels aspired to power that was the prerogative of Christ alone. So what kind of mobility will Lucifer suffer according to Ezekiel? Because he exalted himself. That's the next question. In Ezekiel chapter 28, actually verses 17 through 19, not only 18 and 19, but beginning with verse 17. What does God say to Lucifer? I cast you to the ground. What kind of mobility is that? Down. I laid you before kings, that they might gaze at you. You defiled your sanctuaries by the multitude of your iniquities, by the iniquity of your trading. Therefore I brought fire from your midst. It devoured you, and I turned you to
ashes.
Where are ashes? On the ground, right? Dust. I turned you to ashes upon the earth in the sight of all who saw you. All who knew you among the peoples are astonished at you. You have become an horror and shall be no more forever. What happens when we suffer of this disease of upward mobility? Be sure that somebody will make you experience downward mobility, down all the way. Now, it's been said sometimes that our greatest assets are also potentially our greatest liabilities. God created Lucifer with sterling assets. God created Lucifer actually with four great assets: beauty, wisdom, riches, and a high position of power or responsibility. These assets were meant to bring honor and glory to the Creator, but he appropriated them to himself. Notice what we find here in Ezekiel 28, 17, verse 4 and 5, and also Isaiah 14, 13 and 14, where all of these assets that God gave Lucifer are mentioned and how he actually perverted them. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. Of course, beauty is not a problem today. Is it? Just watch the Oscars. That's all I need to say. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. You corrupted your what? There's another asset. You corrupted your wisdom for the sake of your splendor. With your wisdom and your understanding, you have gained what? Riches for yourself, and gathered gold and silver into your treasuries. By your great wisdom and trade, you have increased your riches, and your heart is what? Lifted up because of your riches. And then you have the position of power. So we've noticed beauty, wisdom, riches, and now he's going to aspire to a position of power. For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. And by the way, he suffered of a serious case of myopia, didn't he? Mm-hmm. Nearsightedness. Do you notice the number of times that eye is used? For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will also sit on the mount of the congregation on the farthest sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. He suffered a serious eye disease. Right?
Yes.
Ultimately, sin is selfishness. The root of sin is selfishness. Now, we have another mystery. It also deals with humbling and exalting, but it's the opposite order. Notice what we find here in 1 Timothy 3:16. How does the Apostle Paul describe the mystery of godliness? Now we looked at the mystery of iniquity, right? It's whoever exalts himself will be humbled. It happened with Lucifer, and by the way, is the papacy going to be destroyed and go down to the pit? Absolutely. At the end of 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, it says he will be destroyed by the brightness of Christ's coming. But now let's notice this other mystery. And there's a sequence here. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh. What kind of mobility is that? Downward mobility. God, who's up there, was manifested in the flesh, in the incarnation, justified in the spirit. I don't have time to show you this other text, but that refers to the resurrection of Jesus. Seen by angels. This is as he's ascending to heaven, the angels are accompanying him. Preached among the Gentiles, that's after the day of Pentecost. Believed on in the world, that's a result of the preaching. And then it says received up in glory, and it could be translated taken up in glory. So do you notice here the movement? First of all, he what? He comes down and he takes flesh, and then step by step he's exalted until finally he's received up in glory. The next page. In the mystery of godliness, voluntary downward mobility is followed by upward mobility. Jesus humbled himself to take human flesh, and as a result the Father took him up into glory. Number two, how did the Apostle Paul describe the voluntary downward mobility of Jesus? Let this mind be in you which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, the word form is morphe, it means being of the very stuff of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. I like the translation in the more modern versions. He did not consider equality with God as something to be hung on to, as something to be grasped, but made himself of no reputation. Who chose the downward mobility? Was he forced by the Father, or did he choose it? He chose it. And took upon him the form of a servant. See, he who was in the form of God now takes the form of a servant. And was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he what? He humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death of the cross. Is that the opposite of Lucifer's mobility? Ellen White wrote that when Jesus came to this earth, he was fully divine and commanded the homage of angels and called forth the adoration of the universe of God. And yet he did not consider equality with God as something to be grasped. So on his own volition, he chose to humble himself, and as Ellen White expresses it, and to give back the scepter into the Father's hands and to step down from the throne of the universe. The Lord became the servant, yet after he took human flesh, he humbled himself even further by dying on the cross. So because he humbled himself, what happened? Well, let's finish reading this passage in Philippians chapter 2 verses 9 through 11. Here's the consequences, the consequence for having humbled himself. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him. Did he exalt himself? No. Did he humble himself? Yes. Who exalted him? The Father exalted him. And also gave him a name. Who gave him the name? The Father, which is above every name. That at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of the things in heaven and the things on earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Because Jesus voluntarily chose to come down, humble himself and become a servant, the Father highly exalted him and gave him a name that is above every name, and commanded that every knee should bow and confess that Jesus is Lord. That is, downward mobility is followed by upward mobility. What did Jesus say to the astonished disciples after washing their feet? Can you imagine that? The king of the universe washing the dirty feet of his disciples. It was springtime. It rains a lot in springtime in Israel, and they wore sandals. Unbelievable, either dusty or muddy. And then he says, I gave you an example so that you should do as I have done. Let's talk about Nebuchadnezzar's arrogance. There's other examples of this mobility issue. What king of Babylon manifested an extreme case of upward mobility? At the end of the 12 months, this is after he has a dream of the tree, and the tree is cut down, but the stump is left. And it says, at the end of the 12 months, he was walking about the royal palace of Babylon. This is 12 months after he gets this dream, and Daniel explains the dream. The king spoke, saying, is not this great Babylon that I have built for a royal dwelling by my mighty power and for the honor of my majesty? And God says, oh yeah? So you think you're great stuff? I will remove the pearl of reason from your brain, and you will act like a beast. Notice number two, what did God do to the arrogant king? While the word was still in the king's mouth, a voice fell from heaven, King Nebuchadnezzar, to you it is spoken, the kingdom has departed from you, and they shall drive you from. Who's doing this to Nebuchadnezzar? He exalted himself. Who's doing it? The watchers, the angels are doing this too. They shall drive you from men, and your dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field. They shall make you eat grass like oxen, and seven times shall pass over you until you know that the Most High rules in the kingdom of men and gives it to whomever he chooses. And then after he recovers his senses, by the way, he became a vegan for 7 years, and his mind became clear. Notice what he said after his trial. Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and extol and honor the King of heaven, all of whose works are truth and his ways justice, and those who walk in pride he is able to put down. Does this have anything to do with the parable of Jesus? Mm-hmm. How about Korah, Dathan, and Abiram? Who was Korah, and to which position did he aspire? Ellen White explains, Patriarchs and Prophets 395, Korah, the leading spirit in this movement, was a Levite of the family of Kohath and a cousin of Moses. He was a man of ability and influence. Though appointed to the service of the tabernacle, he had become dissatisfied with his what? With his position, and aspired to the dignity of the priesthood. He wanted a higher position than he had. He says, I'm only a Levite. I want to be a priest. Maybe this has something to do with women's ordination. The motivation behind it. Who were Dathan, Abiram, Korah's fellow conspirators? These princes, Ellen White explains, readily joined in his ambitious schemes. Being descendants from the eldest son of Jacob, they claimed that the civil authority belonged to them, and they determined to divide with Korah the honors of the priesthood. They weren't thinking about serving in the priesthood, they wanted the honor of being priests. How did the life of these upwardly mobile conspirators end? The eyes of all Israel were fixed upon Moses as they stood in terror and expectation awaiting the event. As he ceased speaking, the solid earth parted and the rebels went down, alive into the pit. Is that what we find about Lucifer in Ezekiel? Absolutely. With all that pertained to them, and they perished from among the congregation. Among many today, the spirit of Korah, Dathan, and Abiram is alive and well. It is seen in the politicking at constituency sessions. It is seen when ministers attempt to outdo other ministers in popularity, baptisms, etc. It is seen in the desire to ordain individuals whom God has not called to the ministerial vocation. It is seen in the attempt to bring others down that we might ascend. Now notice what Ellen White had to say about Korah's rebellion. This is interesting. Patriarchs and Prophets 403. In the rebellion of Korah is seen the working out upon a narrower stage of the same spirit that led to the rebellion of Satan in heaven. So it's a miniature that helps us understand what happened in heaven. By the way, did these three men spread these rumors about Moses? Ah, he wants to lord it over us. And Aaron, he thinks he's the only one that can have the priesthood. You know, they spread this among the people. Did the people side with them to a great degree? Absolutely. There was a revolt in the camp, just like in heaven. Now there's another individual here. His name was Absalom, the son of David. We have all kinds of biblical examples of this teaching of Jesus. Absalom, he wasn't happy with David because he wanted to occupy the position that his father David had. Notice what number one says. Moreover, Absalom would say, "Oh, that I were made judge in the land, and everyone who has any suit or cause would come to me, then I would give him justice." In other words, David doesn't do justice to anyone, but if I could occupy that place, everybody would have justice and would be free. Does that sound familiar? Absalom did not even respect the position of his own father. He conspired to overthrow him, just like Lucifer in heaven had conspired to overthrow God from his throne. What finally happened with Absalom? Well, he had long hair, and his hair was caught there in the tree, and three darts were thrust through his chest. And then notice what happened. Number two, what finally happened to the ungodly Absalom is that they took Absalom and cast him into a large pit in the woods and laid a very large heap of stones over him. He who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. Now I'm going to skip this illustration because I used it earlier today. How about the application to us? Ellen White explains the followers of Jesus will not be popular, but will be like their master, meek and lowly of heart. Then she's speaking about an individual. You are seeking to climb to the highest seat, but will find yourself at the last in the lowest. If you seek to deal justly, to love mercy, to walk humbly with God, you will be partakers with Christ of his sufferings and sharers with him of his glory in his kingdom. So first of all, we have to bear the cross, and then we can wear the crown. But we can't aspire to the crown without first bearing the cross. Number one, what practical counsel did Jesus give? Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. What is Jesus? Lowly. Number two, what counsel did the once arrogant Peter give? Therefore, humble yourselves. Who does the humbling? We do. Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. James, the brother of Jesus, 4:10. What did James have to say about downward and upward mobility? Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. This is all over the Bible. Number four, what counsel did the Apostle Paul give concerning this? What? Let this mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. Right before he speaks about Jesus taking the form of a servant and dying death on a cross and then being highly exalted, he gives the lesson. He said, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. I already read that statement at the end, but I want to tell you a legend that existed among the Greeks, the legend of Narcissus. Have you ever heard the word narcissist? Well, let me read you how this came into existence. When Narcissus reached his teen years, the handsome youth never found anyone that could pull his heartstrings. Indeed, he left in his wake a long trail of distressed and broken-hearted maidens, and one or two young men fell by the wayside too. Then one day, he chanced to see his own reflection in a pool of water, and thus discovered the ultimate in unrequited love and fell in love with himself. Naturally, this one-way relationship went nowhere, and Narcissus, unable to draw himself away from the pool, pined away in despair until he finally died of thirst and starvation. What was his problem? It's a fable, it's a legend, it didn't happen in real life, but it teaches a lesson. What is the lesson? That when you're stuck on yourself, the ultimate result is death. When we serve, the ultimate result is life. Amen. That's what Jesus was trying to teach in this parable about, you know, when you go to this bridal party, you know, don't sit in the very front, you know, as if you're so important. He says, no, sit in the back. And then somebody will come and they'll take you by the arm and say, oh, come on, don't sit back there. You got to sit way up here. And you say, I'm important. Look, the owner of the banquet hall is putting me up here. But on the other hand, if you go and sit in the front, you say, I'm really important. And somebody more important than you comes in. Then the person who called the banquet, he comes and he says, excuse me, a president just showed up. Would you please go sit back there? That would be a humbling experience. Whoever exalts himself will be humbled. And whoever humbles himself will be exalted. The two mysteries of Scripture, the mystery of godliness and the mystery of iniquity. God help us to be members of the mystery of godliness.